thank you for this beautiful time that you've given us this morning, Father. I pray for every man and every woman in this place. I pray that you give us a fertile heart and that you just prepare our minds and our hearts for what you have in store for us, Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, we all say,
Amen.
You guys may be seated. Now, I pray that you really just take the opportunity to Man, just take all that you can get. Try to take all that you can get. You know, out of experience, I know for a fact that everything accumulates. Everything accumulates. And so that's just one thing I wanted to share with you guys, just a little brief brief background, brief summary on where God has brought me from. Just a short life of alcoholism and petty theft and things like that got me in trouble with the law. And you know, wow, I really thank God. I can't express enough of just how amazing, you know, the support is. I've really never been in a location where, especially in a heavily condensed group of people, where you can just sleep so comfortable and everyone is just loving, you know. Really, wow, it's definitely a blessing, and I can definitely see the hand of God working in each and every single one of the disciples. You know, my father had came through the program, the discipleship program, and if you have any fathers and any mothers here that are here today, I just really encourage you that please don't give up. Please don't give up. Whatever you do, please do not give up, because I think if my father would have gave up, I wouldn't have had that predecessing example before me, you know. And so, you may not understand now, but you will later. And so, for all the fathers and mothers that are here that hear my voice, you definitely are paving the way for your children. You really are. You're paving the way for your children. Today, while you talk about feeling inadequate, I definitely feel inadequate after all the great T. Jakes speakers we've had. All the speakers, we definitely have some gifted and talented people in that. I definitely feel awful next to such a specimen like your guys' self. Interesting facts that I wanted to share with you. Christ and after the death. And now the definition of Messiah is the deliverer of mankind. And so mankind, being the only species that needs deliverance, is because the fact that we're the only species that is able to pervert into an abnormality, into a hostile capability of sin that no other species is capable of. And so this is why the creator of the universe, he had to come down in the form of a man, in the form of the species that is the only species that is capable of committing such an abominable hostility. You know, there's no other species that is able to really pervert, you know, as the word of God says. There's no other species. God would have came down as a bird. God would have came down as a dog, and etc. If they were capable of being able to commit such just an abominable amount of sinful behavior. And so Jesus Christ, you know, the creator of the universe, came down in the form of man. This is why he took the place of a human being to be that atoning sacrifice for our sins. And so that's just a quick fact, you know. So maybe you can share this with some of the non-believers or your family members that you encounter. You know, this is factual, undeniable evidence. And the definition of Messiah is the deliverer of mankind. The deliverer of mankind. And so once again, mankind is the only species that needs deliverance. For the same reason that another example is, mankind is the only species that requires law enforcement, you know? And I'm sure we don't see any other species on this entire planet that requires law enforcement, really. I don't have any children, but I know that, you know, my grandparents and my parents, they kind of had a hard time. They haven't had school, and so you know how hard it is for some adults and for some of us to maybe raise our children. You know how hard it is for some humans to raise their children. Well, God, He raises the entire species of birds, you know, together with no hassle. Literally, every bird that constructs his nest is literally an extension of the carpenter. You know, the carpenter, as every bird constructs their nest, they are literally, I pray that you guys would keep an eye open for these things. You know, God really, every chance I get, I try to look at the animals. God really, wow, they are such a great help to really, to just calibrate your mind on the presence of the Lord. And so, I pray that we would just set our hearts, set our minds on the things of God. As the Word of God says, you know, to fix our gaze forward. Fix your gaze forward. And if you're here today, I want you to know that God really loves you, each and every single one of you. And I know it kind of seems like a repetitive act where we come into devotion and we clap our hands, and it almost gets, it can get a little bit tiring, but I want you to know, try not to look so much at the messenger. I'm just a vessel, and I'm just here to share my experiences with you. But I really, sincerely, genuinely want you guys to know that, you know, Jesus has his eyes on you. You are the apple of his eye. Every single one of you has your own unique fingerprint. Not even our mothers or fathers have the fingerprint that we have. And it's the same thing with the animals. Every tiger stripe that you see is different. That every tiger stripe, that's their fingerprint. You'll never see another tiger with the same tiger stripes. That is their fingerprint. So in that same context, you know, we all have a fingerprint story that God really cares about. This is like a storybook that God saves. And so the Word of God is God's fingerprint, and he's sharing his fingerprint with us. And so I just really want you guys to know that you are not on the back burner. You know, God really, deeply, sincerely has his eyes on you. He loves you. You are not neglected. And a couple scriptures that I wanted to read was Romans chapter 8, verses 5 through 6. And the Word of God says, "For those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who are according to the Spirit are the things of the Spirit." Verse 6, "For the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace." And so this morning I kind of just wanted to bring to our attention just what we set our minds on. We have to be able to fix our gaze forward and try to focus on the Lord, really. I know it can be definitely hard. It can be really hard to get a visual, you know. But just try to look at just the factual evidence, you know. I want you to know in your heart that there is so much factual evidence. You know, every single living organism on this entire planet, every single human being, every dog, every animal, has to be born as a baby. Literally. This is factual, undeniable evidence. Every single organism on this entire planet has to be born as a baby. And so if we were to just stop the world, and just for a moment, and keep everyone as a baby, you know, how does God really balance the universe? Look at how he balances the universe for his little babies. Literally, he's like a male seahorse that gives birth to every species. I used to kind of I had a negative way of thinking when I would really just prepare for certain things that I might encounter throughout that day, which would have me an aggressive way of thinking. I come up with these scenarios, you know. Just as the Word of God says, be careful what we set our minds on. And so sometimes we can naturally just prepare and set our minds on certain scenarios that aren't really going to ever happen. And so sometimes we just really contemplate on certain scenarios, maybe just out of fear and anxiety, and we can keep an aggressive scenario in our mind just marinating all day long. And this is what God wants us to work on. You know, He wants to be the center of those scenarios. And so it takes strength. You know, in the world, violence and aggression is just a misconception that people think that makes you more manly, more masculine. And I'm here to tell you that, you know, that's not true. God's ways are absolutely different. God's ways are meekness, which is strength that is under control. And so I just want to share that with you guys. The Word of God says in Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 10, I, the Lord, search the heart, I test the mind, even to give to each man according to his ways, according to the results of his deeds. And, you know, we cannot change time. We can't change time. But during this time that we're in discipleship, you know, I've been at this for some time, and I've gone through programs, you know, and I've been incarcerated and things like that, and I want you guys to know that this is not a waste of time. This is not a waste of time. We can't change time, but you can definitely utilize time, and the way that we can utilize time, we can have time working for us instead of against us. We can have time working as our friend instead of our enemy. And the way that we do that is just through simple devotion, repetition, and developing good habits. Every second, every moment, we have an opportunity to develop good habits. So I want you to know that this time in discipleship, I promise you, please take advantage of the opportunities that we have. Please, I want you to know that you are loved, and don't feel like you're being held against your will, because you're not. Don't feel like you're being held against your will, because you're not. God really has you in a safe place. In a safe place. Your worst day in your discipleship is nothing like in other places, you know. This is normal. A lot of things that we encounter, it's normal. And so, I know when I first got here, I kind of had a little persistent approach on like certain stuff, because it's been a while since I've been in a group setting, and so it was just a little different for me. But God definitely will see you through. And so, developing good habits. So this is what devotion consists of. Devotion consists of repetition. Repetitious acts eventually become a ritual, devotion, a routine cycle that belongs to God. God wants to be the center of our repetition. And so in the gym, I know a couple of us go, and you really don't have to do that much. One word that you can focus on, whether it's the gym, whether it's your discipleship, you can apply this to discipleship, is the word accumulation. Everything accumulates. Everything accumulates. You really don't even have to do that much. Sometimes it's just the most slightest movements, the slightest word. And just like Floyd Mayweather said, you know, just slight word. That's really all it takes. And so, you just try to find your rhythm, find a comfortable posture. Sometimes when you're standing in line, you just try to find a comfortable posture. You have to posture yourself and find God's rest. Now I'm going to finish, I'm going to close out with just 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. The Word of God says, we're destroying speculations and every lofty thing raised up against the knowledge of God. And we're taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. taking every thought captive, taking every thought captive into the Word of God. You have to constantly calibrate your mind. Calibrate your mind. Calibrate your mind. Like service dogs. That's what service dogs are there for, is to recalibrate the way of thinking of their owner. Recalibrate the perspective of the owner. So that's what God is on a much bigger scale. He is our service God. He is the God that we serve. And so He wants to calibrate your mind and your heart to Him. And I promise you that you will never go wrong. Never go wrong. And I kind of have my nose a little bit. I'm just so grateful. I pray that you just have an encouraged day. Thank you so much for your support. I know I wasn't so much like TV Jakes or Joel Olstein or Pastor Matthew, but I'm gonna close out with 1 John chapter 2 verse 15. Do not love the world nor the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And so, for those that speak Spanish, there's a thing called cariño. You know, don't lose this cariño for God. This is where the strength is at, in the cariño. And violence doesn't define masculinity. Being aggressive towards one another doesn't make you more of an adult. Growing a tolerance to perversion doesn't make you more of an adult. And so those are misconceptions of the world. Now we're in the body of Christ, transmitted to the body of Christ. And I want you to know that you guys are at home. You guys are special. And I thought I'd go